Thank you so much for joining us. We hope this ministry has touched you, and we'd love to hear your story. So please contact us at stories@edgewaterchurch.com. Also, if you'd like to support this ministry financially, you can go on edgewaterchurch.com and choose the giving button that works best for you. Again, thank you, and prepare your hearts for today's message.
Without hope. They are alone. They are separated from God who created them and loves them. They face evil every day. They need hope and help and healing. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to help people meet, know, and serve Jesus Christ. You will need to train. You will need to prepare. People are counting on you. The world is counting on you. God is counting on you. The mission seems difficult, but the mission is possible. This video will self-destruct in 3 seconds.
To accomplish then this big mission of helping people meet, know, and serve Jesus, we have to all participate in this. In the Florida conference, we refer to this as radical hospitality. What do we do? How do we help people meet Jesus? It comes through radical hospitality. Radical hospitality means that we're not just friendly and courteous, passively kind of receiving visitors warmly, at least not chasing someone away. All right, that we're talking about something more than that. We need to have a passion. We need to have a restlessness inside because we know there are so many people in our community who don't know Jesus. So many people who are far away and going through life on their own. Do we have that restlessness inside? Because let's face it, we live in such an inhospitable world. People simply just do not go out of the way for one another. Many folks go to work day after day with little or no satisfaction of a job well done. Road rage on our highways is just becoming the norm. We're disconnected from other people. We lack meaningful relationships. We wander through life without purpose, trying to find satisfaction in one false thing after another. Relationships, drugs and alcohol, pornography, work, trying to stay busy, the acquisition of things. We try to use all of those to try to fill that void inside. We try to make it through life, through the difficulties of life on our own. And since we weren't created to do it on our own, we find ourselves miserable and empty and tired and addicted and hurting and desperate. And we just don't know what to do about it. There has to be a place. There has to be a place where people know that they are welcome and loved and respected and wanted and needed. And that place is the church. And that place specifically is Edgewater United Methodist Church. As we at Edgewater United Methodist Church live out our mission to help people meet, know, and serve Jesus Christ, we begin to practice that radical hospitality. We start living in a way that changes how we do things, changes our patterns, changes our behaviors. We work together with an ever-present awareness of the person who is not here. Our neighbors, our friends, our coworkers who do not know Jesus as Savior and Lord. We have people who pray over the empty seats in this room because they represent someone out in our community who needs a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. With every ministry, everything we do here, we need to work on how to reach those who are not yet here. My brother Ken, he's 8 years older than I am. He's someone I really, really look up to. And There was one question he asked me one time towards the beginning of my time here, and it stuck with me through the 13 years of being here now. And he asked this question. He said, how would our church look different if we programmed and spent money thinking about not the last 100 people who did come through the door, but the next 100 people who will come through the door? Well, how would things be different? Because, you know, we like it. Because we like it the way it is, because that's what maybe drew us here. But what about some folks that may need something a little different? Am I willing to give up that thing that I hold on to so dearly so that someone else can be reached? We can't get by with this self-satisfied attitude where we say, well, now that my needs are met, I'm happy. Just don't let anything change now. No, what do? We offer ourselves to Jesus by offering Jesus to others in everything we do. Helping people meet Jesus means that we go to extremes, that we do it joyfully, that we don't take it lightly, because we know that our mission, the invitation that we give, is the very invitation of Jesus Christ. So that's the first thing, is we need to invite. We need to be willing to give a simple invitation with so many people out there in the world around us. Even Jesus himself modeled it. In John 1, 38 and 39, it says, Jesus looked around and saw them following. What do you want? He asked them. They replied, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Come and see, he said. He didn't just go, oh yeah, I'm over there. No, he said, come and see. Come and be a part of it. Come and be with me. We have no problem telling people where we get our hair cut, in my bathroom. We have no problem telling people where we get our car fixed. We have no problem telling people all the millions of places we love to eat. So when it comes to that which concerns the most important relationship that we have, our relationship to God through this church, we need to speak up and make the invitation. Amen. We need to be praying for those people who are in our lives, who aren't connected to God. Why not invite them so they can have an opportunity to connect? Think about the people that cross your path every day. Parents of other soccer players out at the soccer field. People at work. People at school. Do they have a church family? When someone new starts at work or at school or someone moves into the neighborhood, along with all the other nice welcoming things that we say to them, why not add, hey, and if you're looking for a church, I'd be happy to tell you about mine. I love it. It's made a difference in our family. We'd love to invite you to come and join us sometime. A friend of mine used to work for the cable TV company. I mentioned him before. He used to do installs for new people moving in. And in the process of doing his work, he would just kind of casually get into conversation, and he would invite them to come and check out his church, because he figured if they were moving, they might be new to the area. And so he would invite them to church. And I cannot tell you how many people came to that church for the first time because of Roger the Cable Guy, you know, because he invited him to come. We'd ask him, well, how'd you get here? Roger invited us. I mean, it was like, man, we need to put this dude on the payroll. So he was just all over it. Maybe if you know someone who is walking a difficult path right now, difficulty in their marriage, suffering grief or loss, don't be afraid to say, hey, my relationship with God and my time at my church has helped me to get through tough times in my life. So I'd love for you to come and be with me. These simple conversations should come naturally. It's just kind of an extra step in your conversations. Just a couple of tips here. Don't be pushy. All right, nobody likes that. Do it with integrity. Do it in your own style. And be faithful to yourself and God. Just let it be just a part of who you are. We need to invite. So all of that kind of takes place outside of our walls. But then what do we do once people actually make it here? And they come inside our doors. Well, that's when we get more into the welcome side of things. How do we live out radical hospitality in the context of a welcome? Matthew 25, 35 says, For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. What kind of things? Think about it. Remember that single mom I talked about a little while ago. What are some things? What could you do to help that single mom feel welcome? We have to intentionally connect with folks that we don't know. Sometimes we get in the door and we get welcomed and we get connected, and then we sit back and say, well, I got my needs met, and we don't bother to turn back and look for the other person. But we should always be turning and looking back, saying, who else needs connection? Who else needs relationship? Who else can I talk to? Who can I say hi to? Who looks like they need someone to come and talk with them? We all need to be a part of the welcoming feeling that people feel here at Edgewater. So signing up and being a part of Team Orange, that's a great way to be a part of the welcome here. But it can't stop there, though. So inviting gets people here, and then welcoming kind of gets them in the door and gets them settled in. But what do we do from here? The next part is then that we receive. That we receive people. So this step of helping people meet Jesus moves to even more kind of radical hospitality. I want to read this section of scripture from Romans chapter 5, starting in verse 1. It's from the Message paraphrase. It's a longer chunk, but bear with me because I really like it. So Romans 15, starting in verse 1. It says, those of us who are strong and able in the faith need to step in and lend a hand to those who falter and not just do what is most convenient for us. Strength is for service, not status. Each one of us needs to look after the good of the people around us, asking ourselves, how can I help? That's exactly what Jesus did. He didn't make it easy for himself by avoiding people's troubles, but waded right in and helped out. I took on the troubles of the troubled, is the way Scripture puts it. Even if it was written in Scripture long ago, you can be sure it's written for us. God wants the combination of his steady, constant calling and warm personal counsel in Scripture to come to characterize us, keeping us alert for whatever he will do next. May our dependably steady and warmly personal God develop maturity in you so that you get along with each other as well as Jesus gets along with us all. Then we'll be a choir. Not our voices only, but our very lives singing in harmony in a stunning anthem to the God and Father of our Master Jesus. So reach out and welcome one another to God's glory. Jesus did it, now you do it. Amen. So what I want to give you four things here to help you keep in mind as we begin to live out more and more this portion of our mission, this part of helping people meet Jesus, this thing that all of us are to be a part of. Four things. First thing we need to be willing to do is to move out of your comfort zone. To move out of your comfort zone. Again, it's something that Jesus modeled for us. Jesus was willing to do for us. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, it says, but God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us while we were still sinners. Jesus could have just said, no, I don't really feel like it. That impossible mission, no, I'm good. I don't choose to accept it. But no, he was willing to leave his place of comfort, leave that comfort zone, to be willing to come down here to die on the cross for our sins. And so we, as followers of Jesus then, need to be willing to move it out of our comfort zones as well. We cannot just be consumers. You can't do it just sitting still. Second of all, we need to live like Jesus. Our lives need to model this. We need to begin to have these characteristics of Jesus Christ, these fruits of the Spirit show up in our lives. And not just in our time at church. It should be found in every aspect of our lives. That there's consistency, that we're the same person here at church as we are out in the parking lot and out on 41. And I'm hoping that the influence goes this way and not that way. I don't want folks like cutting people off in the coffee line or whatever out here. But that we need to be living Jesus out there. And so, but it's a relational process. We need to build relationship with people. That's one of the things that Jesus did as he went through. He went and talked with people and invested in their lives and spent time with them. And that's what we need to be willing to do as well, to build intentional relationships. And as you build these intentional relationships, then people are going to see the difference that it makes in your life. Then when you are grieving, when you are going through loss, when you are going through hard times, when you are facing difficulties, when you get that diagnosis, how do you live that out that's maybe different from someone who is far away from Jesus? That we have hope, that we have strength, that we have power, that we have community, that we get a chance to be a part of. We need to live that out. We need to demonstrate that for the people around us. The third thing is that we need to entrust the result to God. Entrust the result to God. In John 1, starting in verse 40, it says, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of these men who heard what John said and then followed Jesus. Andrew went to find his brother Simon and told him, we have found the Messiah, which means Christ. Then Andrew brought Simon to meet Jesus. So you notice it doesn't say, then Andrew went through and explained every part of Jesus' theology to Simon. No, he brought him. He invited him. He brought him. He brought him along. He didn't feel like he had to convert him. It's not our responsibility to convert. It's not our responsibility to convince people with our spotless theology. Our responsibility is to respond to God's call and introduce others. Because it's the Holy Spirit's job to convert. It's the Holy Spirit's job to convince as His Spirit meets with their spirit. Okay, we just need to be willing to follow through and invite. And you know, if someone says no, that's okay. Because it's not, again, it's not our responsibility. We're responsible for the ask. And I know sometimes we don't make the ask because we're afraid of, oh, goodness, they're going to ask me questions I don't know the answer to. Hey, they might have heard my hockey words that I was using when the microwave didn't work in the break room or whatever. So, I mean, so there are things that sometimes keep us away from taking that step to tell people. But as we live more and more consistently, allowing our life to, the more and more we live like Jesus, the more it's going to be able to make an influence on people. But again, it's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is to be faithful to ask, to invite. Also then, of course, like we talk about a lot around here, it's a team effort. It's a team effort. In Matthew 5, 16, it says, in the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. And so whose light was Jesus talking about? It says, let your light shine. It doesn't say, let your pastor's light shine. It doesn't say, let your small group leader's light shine. It doesn't say, let all your Christian friends' lights shine. No, he says, your light. We all have a role to play. We all have a light to share. Every single one of us. If we would just all do the small things that we can do, it would be amazing how many lives would be touched, how many lives would be transformed. Because there's so much darkness in that world that is just hungering for light. And here's the thing, you don't have to be any more talented, any richer, any thinner, any smarter, any more or less of anything to be able to partner with God in this. All you have to do is be willing to be used by Him in just everyday practical ways. Little conversations, little bits of encouragement, little bits of you making the right decision along the way. And all of it then begins with turning around and reaching out to others, just like people have turned and reached to us. Deuteronomy 10:19 says, so you too must show love to foreigners, for you yourselves were once foreigners in the land of Egypt. All of us, at one time or another, were strangers to the faith. We were living outside of the kingdom of God. At one time, we were in the darkness. We were lost. We were lonely, without the hope of Jesus. But now, we belong because someone invited us. Someone helped us to meet Jesus. Someone invited us. Someone received us. Someone helped us to feel welcome. Maybe you can just think about who that is. A parent, a spouse, a friend, a Sunday school teacher, a pastor. Maybe it was even just a stranger. Maybe it was that sign out on 41 that just draws people in all the time. But through someone's love, we met Jesus. If we had not felt welcomed and supported in some way, we wouldn't have stayed. Jesus says, I was a stranger and you welcomed me. Whatever you did for the least of these, you did it for me. How would that change our behavior towards strangers if we really believed this? That person who walks in the door, that we get a chance to love and serve, it's like we're doing it to Jesus. Taking Jesus seriously changes our behavior. John Wesley, who I mentioned earlier as one of the founders of the Methodist movement, he and the early Methodists, they practiced radical hospitality. And we talked about it earlier in ways so radical that many in the traditional church, they found it offensive. How radical they were in their hospitality. Wesley preached to thousands of people on roadsides and in open fields in order to reach coal miners and field laborers and factory workers and the underclass, the poorest of the poor, people that the upper crust had given up for as lost. He invited them into God's kingdom and nurtured them in a strong sense of belonging and community. He organized societies and classes for mutual accountability and support and care. And Edgewater United Methodist Church is the presence of Jesus in this corner of the world in which we live. And God has brought us into community in order to help to transform our lives, and then through our lives, transform the lives of the people around us. Helping people meet Jesus means that we pray and we plan and we prepare and we work towards the purpose of helping others receive what we have received. Helping people meet Jesus is more than just kind of common politeness to newcomers, the few visitor parking spaces or whatever. Those things are nice. Helping people meet Jesus is a spiritual initiative. The practice of active and genuine love, a graciousness that has nothing to do with self-interest, but instead we open ourselves and our church to be able to receive others. When we start taking the mission to help people meet Jesus seriously, then the adult Sunday school classes and the youth group, all those life groups out in the lobby, the Bible studies, that every all of us then need to ask ourselves regularly, how are we doing at inviting others to be a part of this? Welcoming newcomers into community, how can we improve at that? Maybe the next time your group meets, you can talk about that a little bit together. To live out our mission to help people meet Jesus involves a change in our attitudes, practices, and values. Good intentions are not enough. Little changes can have big effects, though. What can you start to do? Again, maybe it's signing up for Team Orange. Maybe it's making sure that the group that you are a part of, that you are inviting people to come and join, that you're extending that welcome to people in the community, inviting them to come to church. How are we doing with helping people meet Jesus? Every person who is here is the fruit of someone else's living out that mission, because they invited you all to come, and you came. Who is the fruit of yours? We need to help people meet Jesus. Please pray with me. God, thank you for this time together tonight. I thank you for this mission that you have given us, this mission to reach out and connect with people just like you have reached out and connected to us. And God, for that we are so grateful. We pray that you will speak to our hearts tonight, that maybe you even put somebody specifically on our minds that we can invite. Somebody that we can begin just being more intentional about living out our faith in Jesus around them. God, help our lives be consumed by passionate pursuit of helping people meet your son Jesus. And maybe you're here tonight and you're realizing, you know, that's something I've been missing out on. I haven't really met Jesus myself. I've gone through life on my own, and I fit more of the description of the single mom that walked through the door that just has no idea what I'm even doing here tonight. If that's you, we're so glad that you're here. Thank you for having the courage to take that step. And maybe tonight is the night that you say yes to that offer of relationship with Jesus, that he extends that to you. And today's the day you can say yes. You can have your sins forgiven. You can have your life transformed. You can begin to lose that burden of guilt and shame. You can find direction and purpose. So much fulfillment in life comes just through following Jesus. So we want to encourage you to do that. One of the ways we do it around here is just by saying a simple little prayer. And it's something that we're all going to say together, so don't feel like you're doing it on your own, because we all want a fresh start with God, because we all mess up. We need a fresh start. So I invite you to repeat after me tonight and pray, Dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus to die for my sin. Please forgive me of all I've done wrong. Help me to live for you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen.